Push Learning and Media is a Boston and Providence-based nonprofit that specializes in diversity, privilege, and racial justice education. They travel to schools around New England and the Northeast using pop culture, and in particular hip-hop, to start and maintain difficult but necessary conversations regulating to segregation, cultural appropriation, and racial inequality.
Their in-depth presentation will address how these forms of systematic oppression and the media all impact how we engage with the issue of race in America, particularly in segregated and racially homogenous settings. They will reference statistical research and their own personal experiences in an effort to explore what we can do as individuals and communities to make our society less racially biased. Please extend a warm welcome to Mr. Axelman and Mr. Arias.
School, how y'all feeling? Can I get the volume up a little bit? Can I get the volume up a little bit? I need everybody to stand up right now. I need everybody to stand up in their seats.
Come on,
pull the volume up. It's like a world full of pain that I'll be living in. Hard to say my name, like my throat is full of cinnamon. Trying to spit these images, I've been having the feeling since I was a little kid. What's food for your thought when it's sitting in the fridge? Think I'm giving in, so many years they don't consider me a citizen. So much tears like a river that I'm swimming in. And so much fear, the adrenaline is kicking in. Father tried to get rid of him, he claiming he's innocent. They claim me a criminal, gave him the minimal. His label was a digital, his label was subliminal. And then he say he original, damn. Then he say he original, man. That'll make him invisible, don't make him dismissible. This fame on the physical, see what they did to you, you see what they did. I need everybody hands up right now. Hands up! Rock! Do you see the truth? Do you see the truth? Top, how y'all feeling? Top, make some noise! I said make some noise!
Some noise!
Yeah! Do you understand? Come on! Was it too soon? Was it too soon? So on the count of three, I need everybody to rock their head with me. Y'all ready? 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, rock! Come on.
There's too much space. There's just too much space.
Come on. There's too much space. There's too much space. There's just too much. I have my face. That's not something you push a shark off from. But it kind of matters a lot or not. Like a shotgun cuss. It could be vibing off, it could be hit. But even when it is, most children still know where it is. But some don't, some stay in their rooms, even when it's safe. Or they stay in the suburbs, or they stay in the state. It depends. Some spaces are closed, some spaces are space. Some spaces are most similar to outer space. And some spaces are gentle, but it seems that mean by simple presence and absence. Do you see what I mean? I decided to change space. It was almost like a dream, but did it change, or was it simply misplaced? They'll leave off, they'll move, but if I can move, would that move with me? Cause I'm like glue, the universe moves with me. But if the glue doesn't set, then it's just space. Come on, there's too much space, there's just too much space. Come on, come on, there's too much space, there's just too much space. How you guys feeling today? Come on, come on, make some noise. Come on, I'm like you. You seem to know me, that's frankly hard to tell, but so hard to see. That sounds mighty nice to me. I took a swim in the middle of the night. The water felt like skin, it dripped right off. Like bark, like cars do carbon when they go and they spit. Exhausted, I use paper mache to make a model of the sun. I put it in my mouth, I hit myself because I always wonder what it felt like. The flakes felt good, all that answer to my head. They broke it down like wood, they grew like wood. Skull broke like rocks off guard, like on watch guards, watch cops. I stop like traffic, drop like a casket that broke on the ground like a $1,000 ceramic. Then I move through the dirt just like rain. I went into your head, drew red like fangs. Your mortal ass popped like on the first date. I saw it, your face, don't go at my pace, just wait. Come on. There's too much space. There's just too much space. Come on. There's too much space. There's just too much space. There's too much space. There's just too much space. Too much space. Too much space. There's just too much space. How you guys feeling? Okay, okay. My name's Eric Axman. The Sideshow, come on. Come on, 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 come on. Now, round. How you feeling? Okay, 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 okay. Now, I just rap. He raps and dances. So, again, dancing is significantly harder than rapping, I would say. So, how you guys doing today? Word, word, word. Great to be here again. Thank you guys for having us today on Martin Luther King Day. My name is Eric Axelman. I live in Boston right now. I lived in Providence for a long time. From Maine, originally. Anybody from Maine here? Like two? Okay. All right. Two out of a couple hundred. All right. Anybody from Boston or Providence? Okay. Okay. Not too bad. Who's from Connecticut? Hey. New York? Hey. Philly? Okay, 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 okay. So again, my name's Eric Axelman. I co-founded and co-run. All right, you guys, simmer down, simmer down. You guys good? I know we're very exciting. I realize that. So my name's Eric. I'm an artist, educator, and filmmaker. I do a lot of film stuff, and I co-run Push Learning Media with my man, Oliver, right here. How y'all doing?
Hold on, I'm a little tired.
Dancing takes the breath out of you. Again, rapping, you can just like rap and then be chill, and it's no problem. If you dance.
Oh, it's hard.
It's serious.
So, like Eric mentioned, my name is Oliver Arias. But my stage name is Sideshow. Can y'all say Sideshow? That's what I'm talking about. So, I'm an immigrant of the Dominican Republic. I was born in the Dominican Republic. Shout out to my Dominicans. There's always one Dominican in the place. And, you know, my family migrated from the DR to Providence, Rhode Island, where I spent pretty much my entire life in Providence, Rhode Island. Shout out to the Providence heads again.
There's like two.
Yep.
You were there before. Yeah. You were there before. Maybe, I guess it was all Boston.
Essentially, just to, you know, say a little bit about myself. I'm an international breakdancer and competitor, so I compete on an international level. I travel, you know, across the world in the nation. It's pretty much, you know, representing my crew, the Flow Lords from Boston. Currently, I also have a band called the Funk Underground, and we also tour and travel nationally and do shows. And I also work at Brown University as a teaching assistant, and I work on theater production and teaching like hip hop dance and things like that. So, hip hop, who knows what hip hop is? Show of hands, what's hip hop? Somebody, anything, no wrong answers. You guys don't know what hip-hop is? You listen to it like every day.
What's hip-hop? Yep.
Tupac.
Tupac is hip-hop, all right, all right. Besides Tupac, what else is hip-hop?
So rap. What else?
Right here. Okay, okay, okay.
All right, we're done.
Hey.
All right, guys.
Hello.
The talk's over.
Yeah, we're good.
Yo, that's it right there. So for those who don't know what hip-hop is, like he just stated, hip-hop is a cultural movement that started in the South Bronx in like the early 1970s, post the Civil Rights Movement. So essentially, if you want to think about these conditions, in the early 1970s, after the Civil Rights Movement, and all these activists were either ostracized or assassinated or convicted of crimes, you have a situation in the South Bronx where in the school system, There's barely any arts programs in school and after school. You have a situation where both parents, if both parents are there, are working multiple jobs to sustain the household. And homeowners or the building owners of these project buildings were actually setting fire to the buildings to collect insurance money, you know, from the insurance companies. So these are the situations that hip hop kind of arose out of. And what's really crazy is that hip hop was created by teens from 11 to 14 years old, kids that were from the black community and the Hispanic community. And what's crazy is that hip hop now is a multi-billion dollar industry that is now seen from anywhere for advertisements, education, and you know, different sources of media. So those kids that were 11 to 14 years old that started a culture, not based on what was gonna happen today, but based on what they needed at the moment, started this culture that is now, again, a multi-billion dollar industry. Dr. Dre being the first billionaire hip hop artist, you know, shout out to that. Because you know, they didn't really know where hip hop was gonna go and where it was headed. And essentially what they needed hip hop to do for them was use it for as an escape in the situations that they were constantly living in on a day-to-day basis.
Totally, and these were like little kids growing up basically during the period of the civil rights movement. So again, like, you know, hip hop, most people think it started in the early 1970s, 73-ish. You know, the major civil rights legislation was passed in the late 60s, you know, from 64 to really 68. So these are really the kids of the civil rights movement. And also again, to shout out Oliver, a recent hip hop like magazine named him one of the top 36 breakdancers in the country recently. Yeah, you know. So yeah, so hip hop, again, was basically, again, comes out of this place of really extreme oppression. You know, you can watch videos on YouTube of what the South Bronx looked like in the early 70s. It was a place that was just incredibly neglected by our society. Incredibly segregated, very, very few resources, right? Eventually, you know, America stopped caring about the South Bronx. Think of the South Bronx is pretty close to here. I mean, how many miles is the Bronx from here, you guys think? 90 miles. It's, again, actually very, very close to where we are right now. Right? And what's so interesting is that, you know, it came out of this oppression. It came out of this period of time, right out of the civil rights movement. And growing up in Maine, so I'm from Maine originally. I'm from a tiny town in Maine called Norgewalk. Anybody know Norgewalk? Really?
Yeah, I've been
here. Wow. The only person outside of Maine to ever been to Norgewalk. Round of applause. So it's a town of about 2,000 people, and six towns altogether went to the same high school because no town was big enough to have their own high school. So I went to a town in high school that had about 9,000 people, very, very small. And the way we kind of learned about civil rights was we learned a lot about the Atlantic slave trade. And this is, again, this is the history classes in my high school, and then in AP US history, kind of the highest level of history you could take at Skowhegan Area High School, right? We learned about the slave trade a lot. We learned about Jim Crow, basically the system of oppression, which replaced slavery in America, especially in the South, but all over America. And then we learned a lot about the civil rights movement. So growing up, the civil rights movement was something that was talked about constantly in my school system, which is obviously, you know, a wonderful thing. We learned a lot about the achievements of people like Martin Luther King and Malcolm X and other kind of really important civil rights leaders. But we didn't really learn that much about kind of civil rights issues past 1968. Not that much. So today we'll be talking a bit about kind of the major civil rights issues of our times, while still giving credit to the major civil rights achievements that were made during the 60s. So what do you guys think were the most important achievements of the civil rights movement? What do y'all think?
Selma.
Selma, big time. And what was that indicative of? Kind of what were they trying to change in Selma?
The restrictions that people of color had for registering to vote.
Big time. Voting rights were a huge thing, right? Although black people in the North could vote in certain places in the South, essentially no voting rights. Even though after the Civil War, many states actually had majority black populations. And so for a couple years after the Civil War, when there were voting rights in certain places in the South, you actually had for the first time black senators because they actually had the majority, right? Once Jim Crow came up very quickly, you didn't see a black senator for almost 100, I think over 100, I don't know the exact numbers, but about 100 years in many cases. So voting rights were a huge thing, getting equal access to voting. What else do you guys think?
Boycotting the buses,
big time. And what was wrong with the buses? Why were the buses so fundamentally racist?
Black people sit in the back.
Exactly. So segregation, right? Not equal access to resources. Big time. Those are two huge achievements of the civil rights era. Making those things illegal. What else? A couple other things. Big time. Desegregating schools, right? Up until that point, it was totally legal, right, to segregate schools based on race. My father was born in 1948 in Philadelphia, right? It was legal until he was, you know, it was legal when he was born for schools to be segregated in America. What else? A couple of the things. This is really good though. Fair Housing Act, big time. So again, making segregation in housing illegal. So, you know, from my perspective, kind of like, you know, the major achievements of the civil rights movement were essentially desegregation in schools and public places, like both, again, buses, right, any kind of public places and schools, making housing segregation illegal, right, no longer legally could you segregate housing, voting rights, and then also normalizing people of color in pop culture. That wasn't, again, a legal issue, but again, just normalizing the idea of people of color being successful in America. And so again, you have a situation where, you know, we're, you know, 30 years after Emmett Till is brutally murdered by white supremacists, you can have like Michael Jackson in the White House, right? And that's obviously a very small thing, but that visibility is ultimately important, right? But again, you know, but growing up, we learned about this a lot, but, you know, virtually nothing about racism post-68, and nothing about kind of structural racism post-68. I knew that racism existed, right, but didn't really know how it operated kind of on a daily basis for individuals and for our society as a whole.
And I think it's really important to note that although me and Eric grew up in different diverse situations, where I was living in Providence, which is a majority, which the city was a majority people of color, and he was living in Skowhegan, Maine, which is majority white, we were actually learning from the same textbooks or the same curriculum. And I also essentially didn't even know that there were still like civil rights that could be, you know, I guess debated, post the civil rights movement. And you know, I think this is really important to note because I didn't actually learn a lot about civil rights until I started listening to hip hop music. And there's something called the golden era of hip hop with artists like KRS-One. Who's heard of KRS-One? Public Enemy? There you go, NWA?
Okay.
Of course.
Everyone's heard that.
Of course, because y'all want to go see the movie. So yeah, essentially with these artists, I started learning about, you know, civil rights and actually what that meant to not only, you know, myself, but to other people of color. And you know, one of my favorite quotes from Martin Luther King, put it up, is he says, like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I've seen the promised land. I might not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we, as a people, will get to the promised land. Shout out to Martin Luther King, y'all. And what's crazy about Martin Luther King specifically, and activists like him, is that essentially they were willing to risk their livelihood and the livelihood of their families, you know, to make a change and make a difference for people like him. And I think, you know, that's something that needs to be applauded because, you know, he pretty much sacrificed his life just to make sure that, you know, we could be in the situation that we are in today.
And again, this quote was a day before he was killed. It was April 3rd, he was killed on April 4th, I believe 1968. So again, he really fundamentally understood, you know, that he would likely die doing this, and that, you know, hate in our country was so intense that he would likely be killed. And again, he was killed the next day, shot by a white supremacist, which is obviously, you know, tragic. But again, despite the fact that we, you know, idolized Martin Luther King growing up, still not much about how direct racism affects the lives of individuals. I mean, partly because I grew up in Maine, such a white place. But obviously, it does affect individuals, you know, in a really, really serious way.
So, going and talking about Providence and the situation that I grew up in Providence, again, as I mentioned, it's a city that's about 60% people of color, Hispanics taking about the majority of that percentage. So in Providence, I didn't actually, you know, experience any direct racism because I was growing up around different cultures all the time. I was learning from them, you know, I was going to their family dinners and like, you know, eating different foods, and I was just in a very diverse situation. And it wasn't actually until my godparents, who moved to this town called Fairhaven, Mass, that I actually experienced some racism pretty directly, but in very indirect ways. So Fairhaven, Mass is a small town, it's a suburb that's about 90% white. And there are very, very, very few families of color in this town. Now, when I went to this situation, essentially the way that I look, the way that I dress, and the way that, you know, I spoke and approached different situations wasn't really accepted in this environment. And what I learned really quickly at about the age of like 8 is that unless I basically put a mask on when I entered this situation, it was gonna be very, very tough for me to basically survive in these social situations. So imagine I am 8 years old, and during the week, I'm in Providence, I'm in the public school system, kids of color everywhere, learning from each other, very diverse situation, and every weekend, faithfully, until I was about 16, my mom because she didn't want me to stick around, you know, the project housing area where we lived in, so I didn't get into the violence and also the drug violence that was happening in the early 2000s at the time, sent me to Fairhaven, you know, basically because she wanted, you know, me to stay away from that. And essentially every time that I went, I had to dress a different way, I had to talk a different way, and like Future says, I had to put a mask on, you know what I mean? And, you know, I think it's really important to think about that now, because when I look back, I'm like, wow, I was 8 years old. And at 8 years old, immediately, I knew, I'm like, if I don't change up every time I enter these situations, it's gonna be a problem for me every time. So I wanna show you guys a map of Fairhaven. And if you guys wanna look up these maps, you can go to demographic.maps. You guys can look this up. It's like a Google, I think it's like a Google search. But basically, if you guys wanna look at this key real quick, the blue dots represent the white community, green dots represent the black community, red dots the Asian community, yellow Hispanic community, and brown is mixed race or basic Native Americans. So as you guys can see, and it's, I don't know if the lights can come down a little bit, but this is Fairhaven, Mass. As you guys can see, it's pretty much entirely blue. There's very, very, very few families of color, and essentially this is the situation that I was kind of like going into, you know, every weekend. But if you go to a map of Providence, as you can see, this is the south end of Providence right here. This is the west end. Up there where it's blue and like reddish, that's where Brown University is, where I currently live and work at. So here in the south end, as you can see, majority Hispanics. There are small pockets of the black community in the Southeast Asian community. And as you can tell, the east side is pretty much majority white. And what's crazy about this situation is that I think this is about a mile or 2 miles from each other. I believe the distance from the east side to the south end is like about like 2.5 miles. And as a kid growing up, I didn't actually go to the east side until I was about like 19 years old. And basically that's because, you know, I wasn't told that there were opportunities, you know, or, you know, job opportunities or like, you know, resources that I could attain on that side of town. And, you know, that's kind of, you know, the thing that was happening in Providence specifically is that our teachers, who were majority white, you know, weren't really telling us, the kids of color, that there were these resources that we could attain on different sides of town. Now, who's ever heard of an artist called Mos Def? Mos Def?
Hey.
So Mos Def, I know he's a little past your time, but Mos Def was an artist that was really prominent in the late 90s and early 2000s. And he came out with an album called Black on Both Sides. And in this album, he had a song called Mr. N-Word. And essentially, you guys are gonna, you know, just look at the lyrics real quick and then we'll talk over it.
Late night, I'm on a first class flight. The only brother in sight, the flight attendant catch fright. I sit down in my C2C. She approach officially talking about, excuse me. Her lips curl up into a tight space. She don't believe that I'm in the right place. Showed her my boarding pass, and then she saw the gas. All embarrassed, put an extra line on my water glass. An hour later, here she come by, walking past. I hate to be a pest, but my son, I love your autograph.
So shout out to Mos Def. Round of applause, real quick.
My favorite artist of all time.
It's Eric's favorite artist. So essentially, what I think Mos Def means by these lyrics is that even though he at the time was one of the most prominent hip-hop artists, he had all these achievements, he had all these accolades, even when he was on a flight and the woman didn't know who he was, based on just the color of his skin, or, you know, based on just, you know, basic discrimination, you know, she pretty much thought that he didn't belong there. And you know, those kind of things still happen to me today, where I walk into a facility or a school, dressed just like this, because I'm a dance teacher, so I'm gonna be comfortable. But you know, essentially, you know, people look at me and they're like, oh, are you lost? Do you need directions? You know, are you sure that you belong here? Or, you know, think something along that nature. And I'm like, yeah, my name is Oliver. I'm the person that you guys hired, you know, to teach the dance class, you know? And you know, I'm here with my do-rag and like, you know, my Scully. And you know, it's not until after that I actually, you know, teach the class and, you know, actually like prove who I am and that, like, that show that I'm actually good with the youth, that I'm like kind of welcomed with open arms. But you know, essentially that happens to, you know, people of color all the time. No matter what your accolades are, no matter how extensive your resume is, off the bat, just based on how they look, there seems to be this underlining, you know, theme of racism that happens constantly.
And this happens largely because, again, we live in such a segregated society, and so the great majority of white people can essentially live their lives, right, for the most part, not interacting with communities of color. So that definitely grew up, that definitely occurred when, you know, when I grew up. What do you guys think is the whitest state in the country? Iowa, okay. We got Iowa, Wyoming, West Virginia.
You guys are not even close.
You're not close. Sorry, you guys. So, Vermont is the top three. Let's try to get the top three. Vermont's one of them. New Hampshire is another one. Maine's the other. New Hampshire, Maine, and Vermont, as of the last census in 2010, so every 10 years, right, there's this nationwide census in which we essentially measure characteristics of our entire population. It's where these graphs come from. They're based off the last census, right? As of 2010, Maine, Vermont, and New Hampshire were over 96% white. Maine was 96.9% white. That's where I'm from. So I'm from in an unbelievably white place. When I was growing up, it was about 98% white. It's diversifying a little bit as most parts of the world are. But for the great majority of white people, whether they live in a place like Maine, so this is Maine right here, mostly it's white because there's just no people, right? It's mostly moose and deer and got a very high tree population. It's the whitest state and the most forested state. Very state. But as you can see again, same key, very, very white. I grew up close to where it becomes white, where there's just very few people, right? So segregation exists both on a macro scale, right? So, you know, for me growing up in rural Maine, to actually get to a place that was, you know, majority non-white, you might have to travel 100, 200 miles, or in very intimate settings, like in Providence, right? So if you grew up on the east side of Providence, right, near where Brown University is, even though you live in a city that's majority people of color, you may spend the great majority of your life or your entire life just in a small white bubble. So I taught at a private school for a period of time in Providence, Oliver and I both did, and we would interact with kids who, again, grew up in one of the most diverse cities in America, right? It's about 60% people of color, but had never been past downtown and had never been to other parts of the city, right? And were fundamentally scared to do so, and they would straight up tell us. In high school, they would get more reserved, but in middle school, when they're like, you know, when they don't have much of a filter, they'd be like, oh yeah, I'd never go to the south side. I'm scared of that part of town. Right? And so we have these situations where we oftentimes, again, people of color often feel very uncomfortable in situations that are majority white because white people, right, ultimately have very little kind of interactions with people of color for the most part. Of course, there are exceptions, right? But for the majority of American white people, they can exist in those bubbles for most of their lives. So we've shown you a couple maps so far. Do you guys think the entire US is as segregated as the maps we've shown? Let's just have a couple maps. Can you go back a little bit, back two slides? So this is Waterbury. So up there, the right up there is this school at the very top, in the top left, I believe. I don't know this area that well, but that's correct? Top left, right? So as you can see right here, so this is Waterbury. Again, I don't know these cities that well because I'm from Maine originally, but you have a pretty classic kind of pattern of segregation where you have, in the city center, a lot of Hispanics. As you get out towards the suburbs, overwhelmingly white. Go to the next slide. This is New Haven right here. So New Haven is pretty segregated in the city itself. You have Hispanic and black sections, and then a pretty, you know, near downtown, it looks like a mostly white section. I assume that's where Yale is in New Haven, right? Yeah, I assume that's where Yale is, right? And again, let's shout out any other city. Give me any city in America right now. Chicago. Chicago is a great one. So this is the actual map itself. And if you zoom out, you can see the entire US. Again, so these resources are really, really cool. They kind of just show how it operates on a nationwide. Yeah, so this is US as a whole, right here. Again, out here, there's just not many people, right? But Chicago is a great example. Let's go into Chicago. Chicago is very segregated. Yeah, well, yeah, afterwards, definitely. And okay, so you can see right here, right, as you get out to the suburbs, almost overwhelmingly white, and if you go up a bit more, it becomes very, very white with small pockets. The south side is, and again, orange and green blur a little bit on this color scheme, but the south side is primarily black. In the center, you have a large Hispanic population. North, primarily white. And then again, as you get out to the suburbs, you know, again, pockets of diversity, but overwhelmingly white. Let's go to Detroit. Detroit really quickly. Who's heard of the movie 8 Mile? All you guys, right? Who's actually seen 8 Mile? Wow, we're not too old yet. It's always good to know. What is 8 Mile? When they refer to 8 Mile, what are they talking about? Huh? Train track? Close. Basically train tracks. Trailer parks? Okay. Is 8 Mile an actual thing in Detroit? It's a street. So let's zoom in here a bit.
How do you zoom in?
You zoom in just I'll show you. This right here is Detroit. So as you can see, there's a really, 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 really obvious dividing line between the black and the white portion of the city. That is 8 Mile. So the title 8 Mile refers to the segregating line in Detroit. And most cities, right, Providence, Boston, Detroit, Chicago, have oftentimes specific roads, highways. In Providence, it's really the highway that really splits the city down the middle and the downtown, or in many cases, specific roads that essentially have enforced, you know, and again, it's not a legal enforcement, right? You can't legally segregate people by race in America. But in virtually any city you look at, and any community you look at, there is pretty intense segregation. Detroit is maybe the most obvious example, because it's basically, it's like one line, like, bam. Pretty intense. And again, if you zoom in, there are pockets. Again, there is, obviously, it's not just every person of color lives, you know, below, but it is an overwhelming pattern, which is pretty scary. And so again, for the most part, if you don't get out of your cultural bubble, right, especially for white people, you can live the great majority of your life in a situation where you're not interacting with other cultures. And this definitely, occurs where we live, and unfortunately, it occurs in our schools. So again, as you guys pointed out before, segregation in schools is illegal. You cannot specifically segregate a school by race, right? And that was a really, really important aspect of the civil rights movement, basically making sure that our schools were equal, right? But unfortunately, how our schools operate is that for the great majority of public schools, they operate in localized neighborhoods. So where you live determines where you go to school. And because we live in such a segregated nation, the great majority of our schools are highly segregated. And in the 60s, actually earlier than that, policymakers realized that because this was the case, the only way to kind of integrate schools quickly, right, because again, actually changing where people live is a pretty difficult thing. And we can talk more about that in the question and answer, kind of about how segregation kind of is able to maintain itself over time, right? They basically turned to busing. So what is busing? Exactly. So basically moving certain students to other places to get them to basically to better educational facilities, right? To basically try to change separate but equal, right? And so for a period of time, busing was actually a relatively big priority in our country. And it still is in certain places, like in Boston, for example, there's still a small amount of busing that occurs. I don't know, other parts definitely do. So this is a graph looking at the South and black students going to majority white schools. Basically, the percent of black kids going to schools that are primarily white. And on the bottom, it's basically time. In 1954, 0%, essentially, like literally, in the South, 0% of black students, and I assume this is for students of color in general, went to schools that are majority white. As the civil rights movement kicks off, especially with 1968, there's a huge investment in desegregating schools. So for a period of time, right, until about, you know, the mid-80s or so, our schools in the South were relatively integrated. Of course, not all of them were, right? And again, I don't have numbers for the North. I think they're a little better, but not much better. What happens from 89 onwards? I was born in 1989. I was born December 21st, 1989. So every year that I've been alive, for the most part, schools have been getting more segregated, right? So not only do we live in a society that is fundamentally segregated by race, right? Either on a macro scale or a micro scale, but even the places that we exist in, our public places, are increasingly becoming segregated. Even though segregation by itself is technically illegal. So this creates, again, you know, a pretty kind of scary situation. And oftentimes, when we exist in places like this, we're not actually interacting with people face to face. And again, I can say in Maine, right, we were not interacting with people of color face to face. How do you learn about other cultures? When there's no face-to-face interaction.
Media
and textbooks. Yeah, I mean, the way that I learned about black history, right, was primarily through textbooks and then primarily through music, right? We didn't have smartphones at the time yet. I'm old, I didn't get a smartphone until I was like in college, right? But we saw black people on the news a lot, in our textbooks a lot, and through music a lot. But oftentimes when we only have these indirect interactions, the stories we learn about other people are stereotype stories. And I can definitely say the stories we heard in, you know, a 2,000 person town in rural Maine were not that accurate about kind of what other communities were like. And when we actually have these stereotyped interactions with other communities, oftentimes very negative things can happen from that. Who knows who J. Cole is? Who knows the song Neighbors? Who can tell me what Neighbors is about? So Neighbors is a song that came out on J. Cole's last album, For Your Eyes Only. Who can tell me what the song Neighbors is about? Yes. So this is the music video for the song Neighbors. This is the official music video from J. Cole's song, Neighbors.
I guess the neighbors think I'm selling dope, selling dope. Okay, the neighbors think I'm selling dope, selling dope, selling dope, selling dope, selling dope, yeah. Some things you can't escape, death, taxes, and a rape. It's this society to make everything you feel like a candidate for a Trayvon kind of fate. Even when your crib sit on a lake, even when your plaques hang on a wall, even when the president jammed your tape, took a little break just to annotate how I feel, damn it's late. I can't sleep cause I'm paranoid, black in a white man territory. Cops bust in with the army guns, no evidence of the harm we done. Just a couple neighbors that assume we slang, only time they see us we be on the news and change, damn.
Don't follow me, don't follow me, don't follow me.
Okay, the neighbors think I'm selling dope, selling dope. I guess the neighbors think I'm selling dope, selling dope. Neighbors think the neighbors think I'm selling dope.
Don't follow me.
I guess the neighbors think I'm selling dope. Selling dope. Selling dope. Selling dope. Selling dope.
Shout out to J. Cole real quick.
That's an amazing song.
It's one of my favorite songs on that album. So essentially what happened is J. Cole, before going on his tour, before going on his tour for his second album, which was Forest Hills Drive, he had bought a house in, you know, a majority white neighborhood. And while he was on tour, his neighbors, who assumed that he was, you know, a man of color that was probably in their neighborhood now because he was, you know, doing some kind of illegal activity or selling drugs, pretty much, you know, the only reason that he would belong there is if he was doing those things. So while he was on tour and he was performing his album, he came back and he like had heard of the story, like, the SWAT team basically busted down your door. The neighbors had called the SWAT team and they got a warrant, to go into your house and just, you know, search for like illegal drugs. They found no illegal drugs in his house. And you know, what's really interesting about J. Cole himself is that J. Cole is also part African-American and part white. His mother's white and his dad is African-American. So again, J. Cole is, of this time, he is one of the most prominent hip hop artists, you know, today. He's up there with like Kendrick Lamar and like, you know, Logic, Rhapsody. You know, people really know who J. Cole is. And even though people know who J. Cole is, even people like J. Cole, again, just like the Mos Def story, still get discriminated against based on, you know, the color of their skin and, you know, what they look like.
And again, one of my favorite lines in that song is, again, you know, like, even if the president jammed your tape, I mean, like, Obama listens to J. Cole, I mean, Obama listened to, you know, to J. Cole's stuff, and there's like, you know, so even if the president loves your music, right, this can still happen to you. And again, you know, what, you know, the opening line of that verse is, you know, some things you can't escape. You know, and J. Cole, you know, like in interviews, you know, he's talking, again, this was like an actual security footage of you know, what actually happened. And luckily he had those security cameras up. But again, you know, like, he, you know, some things you can't escape. And again, you know, recently there's been similar things in which, you know, prominent basketball players, you know, who, you know, like, you know, like the biggest basketball players have had racial slurs written on their garages and stuff like that. So, you know, this stuff, unfortunately, you know, this happens in our world, unfortunately. And I think, you know, hip hop has this really amazing history, you know, of really speaking truth to power and being, you know, really raw and real about kind of the ways in which, you know, oppression operates in the world. And obviously that isn't all of hip hop. Hip hop is this, as we talked about before, this massive, massive, at this point, kind of global culture that very much started from people of color, but it also it's this global culture. So obviously not all of that is hip hop by any stretch. But I think today it's really, you know, really heartening to see artists like Kendrick and artists like Chance and artists like J. Cole and Logic. And even, I mean, like 21 Savage had a really good song about, you know, about oppression recently. I forget what it's called, but it's really good. And again, it's, you know, it's really encouraging that there is this really important thread in hip hop and that, you know, it means so much, you know, to so many different communities.
Hip hop. Now let me take you back to a time to when life was nothing but a survival test. We had to learn how to talk, walk, and at the same time, watch your step. We had to grow up fast, couldn't stop to rest. Baby boys just barely off mama's breast. See, at a toddler's best, we had to learn to not forget that the streets have code. You'll get shot for the block you rep. And they'll chop your neck for being off the fence. You see, we turned to hip-hop because we didn't have no options left. So instead of being the thug and pushing dimes and cents, we were more focused on how to make our tonsils stretch. We were trying to spread rhythm out the esophagus, and every hard-working session left us out of breath. Yeah, we couldn't help thinking that the clocks were set. You either end up in jail or as an office temp. Before headlines as a dime and bombs as threats, the best place to be at was the project bench. That's where we got finesse and got lots of wreck before dots effects that travel continents. To stay positive was only common sense, cause we were our own dad since pops had left. And every day you keep wondering if moms was next. Being out on the street pushed her heart to death. She understood nothing of this artist's quest, only looking for her son with an ostrich neck. But it was the only way to get pain off the chest, breathing in and out lyrics if your mind was stressed. You see, hip hop was there for us, no matter how hard the problem gets. The only thing in our lives that gave us oxygen, and it gave us confidence to roam around this metropolis. It showed us the one meaning of what accomplishment. So I don't get on stage to deliver false promises. I just promise this. Hip hop is more than what you think. You see, hip hop is a consciousness. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, going back to talking about hip hop and what hip hop means, you know, especially to, you know, people of color, and actually like what hip hop culture. So imagine, so remember, when I'm talking about hip hop, I'm talking about hip hop culture. I'm not talking about mainstream hip hop, what you hear on the radio. That is a completely different thing. Although mainstream rap comes from hip hop culture itself consists of a couple different things. So I don't know if you guys went back, you know, if we go back to the elements of what we talked about, hip hop consists of rap, consists of dancing, either break dancing or popping, beatboxing, DJing, and graffiti art. And also hip hop is tied together with the principles of peace, love, unity, knowledge, respect, and having fun. So essentially what hip hop is to people that are oppressed, and mainly people of color, is a voice and a way to freely express themselves when they are in these situations. Now, I'm a dancer, and I've danced with people from Korea, I danced with people from Africa, I've danced with people from, you know, from Europe, all the way from Russia, you know, South America, Central America. I've danced with people, you know, from many different parts of the world. And essentially what we all share is this love for hip hop culture. And sometimes I'm in a situation where I don't even speak the language with the people that I'm dancing with, but we, you know, we relate. We're like, oh yeah, yo, oh, that was sick. You know what I mean? Like, so hip hop is a culture that essentially, you know, we all understand, you know, on a very, very spiritual level. And, you know, I think what is awesome about hip hop and why today is so important with hip hop is that, you know, activists like Martin Luther King, you know, pretty much his quote, which I'm about to quote, "I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character." That quote itself lives within hip hop culture. So, in these dance competitions that I go to, the color of your skin does not matter. It's all based on the skills that you bring to the table that day. And the person that wins is the person that wins. But you know, what's really interesting and some of the things that, you know, are kind of starting to be talked about at these dance competitions is that essentially, even though we, you know, hip hop, you know, is creating a neutral space, you know, for these things to happen, you know, once the jam is over, you know, everyone kind of goes back to life. And you know, if my friends from Russia get pulled over by a police officer and I get pulled over by a police officer, most likely those are gonna be two different interactions.
And it's been really interesting talking with people who, again, are part of hip hop culture, you know, who are white, and we can kind of talk about this a bit later, who come from other countries like Russia, who kind of, you know, wanna be part of hip hop, and that's great, but then kind of aren't really understanding how race operates, you know, in America. Which is because hip hop means such different things to different people because we live in such segregated places. So I'm from a tiny town, right? What do you guys think was the most popular form of music growing up in rural Maine? Classic rock, okay. More participation, come on. Classic rock, what else?
Bluegrass.
Bluegrass? Country music? Those are all definitely true. All right, so to give you a measurement, we had, growing up, every Friday, and it's amazing that this occurred in my town, in Skowhegan. Every Friday, from like fifth grade to eighth grade, there was a dance every Friday at our community center that was essentially unchaperoned. So how our parents thought that was, you know, allowed that to happen, how that happened in general is beyond me. I have no idea how that happened. But from fifth grade to eighth grade, there was it's like three chaperones in the whole place. Bunch of fifth grade, eighth graders just dancing together, right? And I would say, thinking back, the music we listened to, right? And I don't know who the DJs were typically high school students. They're like my friends, you know, my brother's friends thought they were the coolest people ever. That was my goal at the time, to be a middle school dance DJ, which I still can do. There's still time. And if I think about the music that was played at those dances, right? Probably about 30% country. Country was huge, right? Country was really big. Probably like 10% rock, maybe 20% rock, and 50 to 60% hip hop. Mostly at that time, just gangster rap. So at these dances, right, all white kids. 99% white kids. The artist we listened to most, 50 Cent was really, he was the one who was popping at the time. So, you know, my memories from those, and they're very visceral memories, right? This is my childhood. You know, the soundtrack to my childhood is hip hop in this very strange way. This is not unique to me, right? They would literally, you guys remember Soulja Boy? You guys know Soulja Boy? Yeah. They would play Soulja Boy in our auditoriums at pep rallies, right? They would, for example, like I played varsity soccer, like our warm-up music was just all gangster rap, primarily, right? And so this weird kind of fusion of country and gangster rap. But gangster rap was really the dominant form of music. I mean, we were at a bar recently in Skowhegan, and I told Sideshow this. I was like, yo, in Maine, like, yo, everybody listens to hip hop. And I'm like, you know, I don't think you fully believe me.
No, so we were at this bar in Skowhegan, and I remember they were playing like Lil Uzi Vert and Lil Yachty. And then I look over and I see who the DJ is, and it's like this old white dude, gray hair. He had like the cohorts, he had like, you know, like the plaid shirt. I think he has like some overalls or something. And then I remember like he like changed the song, and it was like some like something that was like rock. And I was like, no, put it back.
Want
Lil Uzi Vert or something. And I'm like, wow, that's crazy. And I looked at Eric, I was like, yo, is this really happening right now? So like, it was really crazy that like, you know, I was in a situation. I was actually the only person of color, I think, in the situation. And like, the only thing they were playing was hip hop. And like, I'm pretty sure they played hip hop, whether I was there or not, so.
Yeah, they definitely play it, yeah. They play it all the time, right? And so what's so interesting is that, you know, for white communities, even though we're fundamentally segregated, right, really segregated, we still interact with the other forms of music constantly. And again, it creates really interesting ways of kind of thinking about, you know, other people, and but in some ways it's good, right? You know, in high school, for example, although I was mostly listening to mainstream hip hop, listening to 50 Cent at the time, Wu-Tang was huge, et cetera, I did listen to some political hip hop. My friends did too, and so we did get some kind of political insights into kind of the lives of people of color, right? So that was beneficial. But for the most part, it was kind of just fun, right? To us, kind of like mainstream hip hop and hip hop in general was just something that you play at middle school dances, right? It was super fun, right? It was basically this fantasy, right, of kind of what cities were like. Again, we grew up in, growing up, I couldn't see any houses from my house. I grew up in the woods, like deep in the woods. So all my neighbors were just trees, you know. They weren't very good neighbors, to be honest. Not great for conversation. But, so that was, again, you know, that was, you know, our lived experience. But what's so interesting, even though I listened to hip hop constantly, I was obsessed. I began rapping in high school, and then again, later on, kind of began learning about civil rights issues. Even though this was such a big part of our lives, I had no idea that major civil rights issues still existed, right? Even though I was listening to black voices, right, constantly, my friends were constantly, I had no idea what the major civil rights issues of my time were that were affecting the people I was actually listening to. And most importantly, even though a lot of the songs that I was listening to were actually about, in some cases, because it was mainstream music, drugs and prison, I had no idea about what the war on drugs was, and what mass incarceration was. Kind of these issues that are so fundamentally affecting people of color that I was listening to for hours a day, and I can't stress how obsessed I was. And again, this doesn't just happen in Maine. For example, on the east side of Providence where we used to teach, right, we would have kids who, again, lived on the east side of Providence their whole lives, never been to other parts of the city, but watched Sway in the Morning. You guys know Sway in the Morning? Yeah, Sway in the Morning or The Breakfast Club.
Yeah,
these hip-hop shows for hours a day on their phones. Hours a day.
And then when we would invite them to like these hip hop like community events that are, you know, really safe, they're in the community, they were like, oh,
no,
we don't want to go to the South Side.
I'm good. We're good. And they really thought they knew what hip hop was. They're like, yo, like, and there was one interaction we had with this, where these two white kids wanted to run a hip hop workshop. And we were like, okay, like, you know, it's kind of funny because you want to run this hip hop workshop, but whenever we invite you to actually go to hip hop events sponsored by the school that are in non-white places, you say no. And why do you guys do that? And they're like, oh, no. Like, we know everything we need to know about hip hop because we read mad internet forums. And so their version of hip hop, right, and their version of black culture was internet forums. And they were dead serious. They were dead serious. They really thought they could get all the information they needed from internet forums, never actually having face-to-face, you know, interactions. But so, in a, you know, and so what's so interesting is that, again, there's this, where white people oftentimes are so obsessed with black culture, but just have, again, this fundamental lack of knowledge about what the war on drugs is and what mass incarceration is. In my mind, kind of the biggest civil rights issues of our time.
Can anybody name what the war on drugs actually is? Anyone?
Come on.
War on drugs. Say again? Yes, it has to do, the war on drugs does lead to mass incarceration. So basically what the war on drugs is a set of policies and laws that incarcerate people, you know, based on major and minor drug use or distribution, really. So, essentially, what happens is that, you know, and we, if we look at this graph, as you guys can see, you guys can look up all these graphs, you know, on your own, is that we see when it comes to marijuana use, essentially, you know, we're just going to be talking about whites, whites and blacks, as opposed to marijuana use. You know, they pretty much do it at the same percentage. And you can see on this graph from 2001 to about like 2010, it's pretty much been used at the same percentage, at the same rate. And, you know, you can't really, you know, note the difference. Some graphs will say that, you know, white people use marijuana at a slightly higher percentage. And, you know, the graphs pretty much, you know, change over time. But as you guys can see on this next graph, is that, you know, black people and people of color in general are pretty much arrested at much higher rates than white people for pretty much the same amount of use. And if you look at this next graph, so from about 1925 to about 1971, our population in our prisons pretty much stayed about the same rate, which is about like 200,000 people per year in the prison system. And then once the war on drugs was, you know, pretty much launched, from 1971 to pretty much present day, our prison system population increased 800%. And to this day, you know, America has about 2 million people in our prison industrial, you know, complex.
Totally. And, you know, and again, this comes from, you know, a variety of issues. And one is, again, drug use is a huge part of it. And again, not all of our prison population is filled with drug offenders, but that's, you know, a really, really big part of it. And what's so interesting is that, you know, the drug war really launched right after the civil rights movement, right? So just as, for the first time, we had, you know, equality in many aspects of our lives, you know, all of a sudden there's this kind of new form of oppression which takes its place, you know, very rapidly and very quickly. And I guess, essentially, again, what the war on drugs does is, you know, basically punish drug crimes with, you know, very, very long prison sentences, oftentimes decades of your life for a very small drug charge. And again, we're not making any kind of moral argument about whether drugs are good or bad in any way, right? But essentially, it not only treated people of color very differently than white people when it came to drugs, but also decided that drugs are not a public health issue, but fundamentally criminal issue. So someone has a drug problem, right? The solution is not to try to help them, but to lock them in basically a cage for you know, decades of their lives. I mean, not only was this incredibly unique in American history, as the last graph showed, right? Until, you know, 1970s, we had a relatively small prison population, but it's incredibly unique in the history of the world. This is the incarceration rates, basically the number of people that you incarcerate per 100,000 people of a bunch of countries in the world. America has by far the largest incarceration rate, the highest incarceration rate of any country on earth. So regardless of size, America puts more people in jail by far, it's not even close, than any other country on earth, right? And not only is our rate higher than any country on earth, but the total number of people we have in jails and prisons is way higher than any country on earth. So we have, what's the population of the US, roughly? About 320 million at this point. When I was like, you know, 10 years ago, it was like 300 million. It's a little more than 300 million at this point. So we make up about 5% of the world population, right? We're the third largest country by population in the world. China and India are larger than us. They both have about 1.2 billion-ish, right? We make up about 5% of the world's population. What percent of the world's prison population? 25%, right? So we have 20—we have a quarter of all the world's prisoners are in American jails, right? And people of color make up about 40% of the population of the U.S., make up about 60% of the prison population. White people make up about 60% of the population in the U.S. and only about 13% of our prison population, right? So white people, of course, are affected by this, right? By mass incarceration, right? A large number of them are in jails, but the numbers are pretty staggering comparatively, right? And again, if people of color did drugs at way higher rates than white people, and we thought that this was a good idea to put people in cages for drug use, right, this would make sense. But they do not, right? Most studies show this, and again, you guys really look this up. Again, there's, you know, most studies show that drug use by race is very, very similar. Most show that white people do drugs at slightly higher rates than people of color on average. But every single state you go to, and in many cases, every single town you go to, we do a lot of work in Rhode Island, and the Rhode Island ACLU has even done, you know, a lot of really great work in looking at just arrest rates in individual towns. And in every single town, the arrest rates for drugs are higher for black people than white people. In every town in tiny Rhode Island, right? So this issue is really a fundamental issue to how our society operates. And it operates in a couple different ways. One is simply policies, right? Policies that, you know, really specifically target certain neighborhoods over others, and also just perceptions, right? In that J. Cole video, those neighbors, again, it was a very, very affluent white place. They really thought, right? They really thought the only way he could have moved there was by selling drugs. Like, they were really convinced that the only way a person of color could have made money to sell drugs, which is just tragic, right? Really tragic. And so again, so racism in America obviously operates on a person-to-person interaction, but it also has these really massive society-level effects which really, really impact our lives. And so obviously, it's really important to, you know, applaud the work Martin Luther King did. You know, he gave his life for this, you know. But his work is not over, and I think oftentimes, you know, growing up for me, you know, we kind of idolized Martin Luther King as a way of kind of being like, you know, this is again in rural Maine, this is white rural Maine, being like, oh yeah, he was so great, so we're done now, right? Like, we're kind of good, right? We can celebrate him, we're good. And that was really, I don't think, what he wanted, right? He knew that this was going to be a very long battle, right, and that equality is not achieved easily. Like, right after slavery ended, right, it took 100 years for black people to be able to vote in a large part of the country, you know, which is pretty crazy. It's pretty intense.
So we want to thank you guys for coming out and, you know, participating in this talk. A round of applause for yourselves. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Yeah. So we're going to do like a quick Q&A if you guys want to, you know, be involved in the Q&A.
And then we're going to do some stuff, some interactive stuff with you guys, which yeah. I think you guys are ready for. But first of all, yeah, I just want to open it up.
I'm going to sit down because I'm tired.
So, any questions or kind of comments about the things we're talking about, both in terms of just how racism operates, our work together, anything? What y'all think?
Bam.
How do people explain, like, how do people, police officers and police chiefs explain the disparity in incarceration, in arrest rates?
Some are very aware of it. I mean, like, you know, some are aware of it. I think it happens for a variety of reasons. For example, you know, in Providence, it happens for a lot of reasons. A lot of it, yeah, we'll tell it, yeah. A lot of it is simply where police are distributed. So basically, you know, you have a limited number of police officers in your area, right? You have to figure out what areas you're going to police, right? And in Providence, for example, the number of police in areas of color are simply higher. And it's largely because of perceived crime, and certain crimes probably are higher, right? But in terms of drug crimes, I would say the drug crime capital of Providence is probably Brown University, where I went to school. Do you guys know Van Jones? He's a really cool, I think he does on CNN, he writes for Vox, he's a kind of, he was in the movie 13th, and he said, you know, he's a black activist, and he's like, you know, I spent a lot of my time in one of the biggest drug capitals of America, Yale University, right? And again, so in Providence, in Brown, for example, right? Brown, the college that I went to, had a series of policies created, I think, in the 60s and 70s, which basically made it so the Brown police were not able to go inside of Brown dorms for any reason except for if someone got called for something violent happening, right? So basically, Brown police cannot come into our dorms, I went a long time ago, right? For any reason, right? Except if something violent's going on, which essentially legalizes drugs on Brown's campus, right? You can do drugs as much as you want, basically, right? And police can't do anything about it unless something violent is happening, right? So on certain parts of the city, right, drugs are essentially legalized. On the east side, other parts of the east side that are mainly white, people are largely probably doing drugs, if they're doing drugs, in their houses, right? Or there's just not a perceived crime threat. We have these stereotypes of crime in other parts of the city, right, for example, the south side, so the great majority of police resources are put in those areas. When the great majority of police resources are put in those areas, you are going to find more drugs, no matter what, basically. If you have an entire population, you know, in Providence, right, obviously not everybody's doing drugs, but if you have a significant amount of the population that's doing drugs, and then you put police resources only in a certain place, you're going to overrepresent that population in your number of arrests. Some police chiefs are very aware of it and are, you know, really understand, like the book, The New Jim Crow, which was kind of the first book to kind of by Michelle Alexander to kind of really kind of flush out how mass incarceration operated, came out in 2010. Like, many police chiefs read it at this point, which is really good. Some people are aware of it, but not enough, I would say. But in Providence, for example, like a good friend of mine did like police youth dialogues, and like their police chief at the time, like a couple of years ago, was reading The New Jim Crow. So, you know, people are aware of it, but not all communities are. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's I think it's pretty unjustifiable, I think, because it's so obvious, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's also been situations where, you know, Eric was actually in these situations where we were at the Dominican Festival that happens every year in the summer, and I believe it was like, there was like a curfew for it. It was like 10 p.m. or something. And, you know, the police were pretty much there, you know, telling everybody to go home. And I was just kind of like, you know, on the corner, like standing on the street corner with my friends, trying to figure out my ride situation. And he's like, oh, what are you doing? He's like, you guys got to go home. And I'm like, oh, I'm just trying to figure out my ride situation. And he steps up to me and like, he's like, you're not going to win this battle. And I'm like, what battle, dude? He's like, I'm trying to figure out my way home. You know what I mean? And it's like small situations like that. And especially when I was working in Newport, which is like a city an hour away from Providence in Rhode Island, you know, essentially Newport is known for being like this like lush and like, you know, rich place in Rhode Island. But, you know, the communities of color, you know, are pretty much, you know, sent to like these like small housing projects, you know, in like this small area in Newport, and the police stay there all the time. And like, I asked, like one day I just went up to the police officer and asked him, like, you know, why are you guys here all the time? And he said, this is where the action's at. And I'm like, what do you mean, dude? Like, so you're basically saying that, like, you know, you're just here because you're assuming that because there's people of color here that something is gonna go down. And, you know, and these are the things that people of color experience on a daily basis. Like, I've walked down the streets of Providence, you know, all the time, and then, like, you know, like a DT will like stop and he's like, hey, what are you up to? And I'm like, I'm just going home, officer. And he's like, oh, all right, we're just looking for the coke and the drugs. Like, this is my interaction with a police officer. Like, 9 times out of 10.
Whereas my interaction with police officers, except for that one instance, so I was there with Sideshow on that day, right? And I was the only white person with a bunch of people of color. It's the only time a police officer has acted aggressively towards me and, like, you know, threatened basically force. And I was like, I was pretty scared. Because again, I was with my bunch of friends, Sideshow and our friends, and it was all people of color. And then the great majority of people there in general, people of color. And about 2 months beforehand, I was driving on the east side in my car, and I ran a red light. Like, not like a big red light, but I was like turning yellow, and I was like, I can make it, I got it. And as I'm speeding through, I wasn't hurting anybody, right? But I sped through, and I looked to my right, and there's a cop right there, and I'm like, oh, crap. So the cop pulls me over, and she comes down, and she's like, oh, that was funny. And I'm like, oh, yeah, my bad. She's like, okay, can I see your license? I'm like, oh, yeah, I have like a paper license, like, I'm getting it soon, whatever. So, all right, can I see your insurance? And I was like, oh, I left my insurance at my house. And she's like, oh, don't worry about it. She's like, do you go to school around here? I was like, yeah. She's like, oh, cool. All right, see you later. I'm just like, nothing. I didn't have my registration. My registration wasn't updated, right? She didn't even ask me for that, right? So again, and these are two examples. This is not statistical, right? But in my experiences as a white person, right, I've never had negative experiences with police officers. The only time has been when I've been the only white person. And again, this is not to say that all police officers are racist, obviously, right? I know many good, great police officers. But also, when your job, right, is purely to police a certain area, right, oftentimes with people who are not like you, right? So again, I don't know the numbers in Providence, for example, but, you know, historically, police forces have largely been white as well, and so you often have, again, largely white police forces. And again, this is not in every city, right? And Providence, I know, is trying to diversify their police force. You have largely white police officers in largely communities of color that fundamentally don't understand those neighborhoods and also have stereotyped ideas of what actually goes on in those neighborhoods. So I think that's a really big part of it too.
And that doesn't just happen with like the police like department in Providence. That also happens like in the school department as well. Like, for example, and these are like real statistics. I believe The kids of color represent 95% of the population in the Providence Public School Department. And I think it's like 95% of the teachers are white. And most of them don't even live in Providence. Or if they do live in Providence, they don't live in the same, like, you know, like economical situations that the kids live in. So it's like, you know, these weird situations where the people that are like in positions of authority don't actually understand, you know, like the people, you know, who are they're trying to, you know, like, you know, be authoritative over, I guess, you know.
And sometimes, again, they really care about the kids too. It's like, you know, in Providence, again, like there's really wonderful teachers, right? But if you're a student of color, right, and you know, you make up 95% of the population and about 90% of teachers are white, you know that teacher is trying to do a good job, right? There's obviously a power imbalance, right? A really obvious power imbalance. And so that, again, you know, occurs, even though Providence is majority, you know, people of color, and our mayor is a person of color, the past two mayors have been. So even though some positions of power are people of color, right, the great majority of positions of power are still held by white people, even though white people make up a minority of the population. Great question, really good question, yeah. What else, you guys? What y'all think?
How can we better explain to people the challenges that America is facing now because of the great fear of ethnicity?
Yeah. So I mean, one of the best things that I use are like statistics. You know, like these statistics like are real, and like there's like, obviously I recommend documentaries to people all the time. Like, I don't know if you guys ever seen 13th. It's on Netflix. It's an amazing documentary that talks about the 13th Amendment and pretty much how that, you know, freed slaves, but also like what that actually meant, you know, as far as like incarceration and like, you know, how the laws changed, you know, for incarceration for people of color, you know, mainly black people. And also there's this new documentary called Freeway, which is about Freeway Ricky Ross, who was like the crack cocaine drug dealer that was, you know, that was like really, he was like one of the kingpin drug dealers in LA. But talking about how like, you know, he was doing that, but also how like the CIA was also involved in bringing that cocaine in, and they were using that to like, you know, help fund the Nicaraguan war. And these are like, you know, I'm very open to conversation with people. You know, if we're gonna have this conversation, I'm down to talk like stats and statistics. And you know, honestly, I recommend like all these documentaries and all this information and books like The New Jim Crow when we're having these conversations, because it's like, it's not a secret anymore. Like people of color, even though we've been through the civil rights movement, you know, obviously, as you guys can see in the media and things that are happening, like, you know, things for people of color are still like, you know, very unfair. And, you know, that we're still kind of going through like, you know, similar narratives that we've been going through, you know, for years and years and years.
And I think stats are obviously a huge part of it. And just, you know, because, you know, it's pretty obvious, you know, I think mass incarceration is such an obvious way to show how, you know, how oppression works in America. But I think also, you know, stats are obviously really important, but I think, you know, like I was talking with my cousin, Mark, who's like our friend, you know, and like, you know, and, you know, for him, it's, you know, he's an older white dude, he's like in his mid-60s, and like, he gets it, he's the man, you know, like you know, he's really tried to integrate his life in an important way, but didn't really, you know, when he was a kid, still lived in very white places, right? And then I think if you live in very white bubbles, you know, and you raise your kids in, you know, in very white bubbles, even if you know the facts, even if you know the statistics, you know, racial stereotypes are still going to be part of your you know, your thought process, no matter what. And you know, it's really interesting. I'm currently a grad student, and I have these like two really interesting mentors, and they're two women in their 60s, one Afro-Cuban, one white, who've been doing civil rights work for like 40 years. And I'm like, you know, to the white one, like, do you still have racist thoughts? You know, when you're 60, you've been doing this for 40 years. She's like, yeah, you know, I still do. And you gotta be real about that, because you know, if you grow up in a very racist society, right? You know, no matter, even if you grow up in an integrated place, right? If you know, our media is still very racist, right? And you know, and so it's very difficult to, you know, to correct that. You know, I think, again, living in integrated places and just being around people who are different than you from a very early age, I think, is the most important thing. I mean, obviously cultures exist and cultures, you know, are very different in America, but also, I mean, like, if you're just chilling with people and actually just, if you're just interacting with people, you see their humanity very quickly. And I was talking with another grad advisor of mine who's a Haitian woman, and I was talking about, you know, white allyship and kind of the right thing, you know, because I'm obviously a white person doing this work, and, you know, it's very important to me to kind of think about my role in this stuff. And I was like, how can I be a good ally, and how can I, you know? She's like, yeah, like, just be a friend and just be a person. She's like, you know, I think these terms, like ally, which I think are in many ways important terms, also kind of make this difference. And race ultimately is a social construct, right? Obviously, our skin colors are different, we come from different places, but how race is conceptualized in the 20th century, right, is a European made-up thing. You know, so, you know, I think just the more interactions people can have from an early age with other people, real interactions face-to-face, I think, is the most important thing. Because again, you know, like, I grew up in rural Maine, and no matter how long I do this work, I'm gonna have racist thoughts, you know? And that's, you know, I can do my best. You know, obviously I know those are ridiculous thoughts, right? But I mean, I grew up, you know, it's like, and white people have to deal with that. And I think try to, you know, be honest about that and try to move past that. But I think it comes from integration. I think, you know, important things were integrated after the civil rights movement, but it was only a very small portion of really integrating our society as a whole.
The notion of reverse racism, that phraseology has entered our lexicon in the last decade. Can you speak to that and how you conceptualize and parse that out? Like, how do you understand what reverse racism is? If it's actually a thing, or it's a is it, what is it?
Yeah, no, that's that conversation has a question?
Yeah, so it was about, okay.
The question is the notion or the phraseology of the word reverse racism has entered our American lexicon in the last decade. Can you speak to how you conceptualize what that is, if it's actually a thing or not?
Good question. Good question.
Yeah, I mean, I've had these conversations with friends, you know,
and roommates.
Yeah, and roommates all the time. So yeah, I try to live in very diverse situations where I'm around people, you know, from everywhere. But I think definitively, if you're just gonna talk about the definition of racism, do I think people can be racist towards other cultures? Yes. If someone is, for example, if I am a person of color and I am quote unquote racist towards someone that is white, does that affect them in the grand scheme of things? I don't think so. You know, I think systematic racism is something that we have to look at when we're talking about reverse racism. Because although, you know, I can call you names or be racist towards you, if you're white, it doesn't affect you in the grand scheme of things, because the majority of the country is 60% white. And, you know, also it's like, we already know that, you know, the way that things are set up, you know, people of color are pretty much at the bottom of the barrel when it comes to these things. And yeah, I honestly, having these conversations, you know, it's very tough, but you know, what I've you know, kind of like gotten from that is that although like definitively, again, people can be racist, if I was being racist towards Eric, it wouldn't really affect him. You know, it wouldn't affect his job. It wouldn't affect what he does on a day-to-day life. You know, it probably wouldn't affect him at all. It might hurt his feelings, and that's a real thing, and that's also valid. You know, you can't take that away from that, but at the end of the day, is it going to be affected by it? I don't, like, not really.
It's structural versus kind of personal racism. Yeah, I mean, definitely, I mean, people can hate you for being white, obviously, but structurally, you start getting the advantages of being white. So that's what I think about, you know, in terms of reverse racism, you know, in terms of personal interactions. In terms of, like, structurally, like, this really interesting conversation that we had a couple years ago with this this Russian dude who's like a hip-hop artist, right? He grew up in Russia, and I think had a hard time in Russia. I mean, like, you know, his life was not easy. Right, and then came to the U.S. And went to Brown, you know, and again, like, paid his way through part of it. Like, you know, he definitely had a hard time. But we were talking about the fact that, you know, you're an American now, and even though you've had, you know, a difficult upbringing, right, you're going to get the benefits of being a white dude in America, especially the fact that he went to Brown, right? And he was really pissed off because there were these internships he wanted to apply for, and there was a couple of different internships that were specifically for people of color, right? And he was outraged. He was like, this is so unfair, like, this is reverse racism, this is discrimination versus me, right? Why can't I get into that, right? And I was like, this is how I would think about it. I was like, you are right, right? There are, like, the other internships don't have, right, a specified race for who can apply, right? Whereas this one does, right? But if you look at actually who's getting the internships overall, right, it's mostly white people, right? And again, if you look at most positions of authority, it's mostly white people. And because we have this, you know, legacy of such ingrained and fundamental racism, right, that has not allowed people of color to attain positions of power, specifically creating those positions for people of color, I think is a totally valid thing to do, right? It's essentially, right, I mean, you know, it's, you know, for example, like the issue of, you know, should colleges have diversity quotas, right? Should we create a specific amount of, you know, universities, positions in universities, you know, affirmative action for people of color? Some white people would get very mad and say, how are you doing this? This is racist, this is discriminating against me as an individual. But what I would say to them is that, you know, well, you know, for up until 20 years ago, you know, all, or 30 years ago, you know, 90% of all the, you know, positions in these schools were white people for the most part. And then, you know, if you go about 60 years, you know, 90% was all white males. So, you know, I think because people of color have been excluded so specifically, And so purposefully creating positions for people of color, I think, is a very reasonable way to help fix that. Again, people would say that that discriminates against people, but I would say the system as a whole discriminates against people of color so obviously that creating those positions makes sense. And so my thing to him was like, yo, like, you're gonna get another internship, dude. Like, you'll be fine, right? Like, you're going to Brown, you're a white dude, you have a white sounding last name, chances are you're gonna be okay, right? And it's okay that there are spaces set aside for other people. That's a very reasonable thing from my perspective. But I think people are very angry about affirmative action in general. I think because, again, they view it as, you're taking something away from me, but white people have a lot, right? I mean, like, you know, if you look at Congress, you know, it's overwhelmingly white, you know? I think there's only, at this point, one or two black senators. I mean, Obama was the first black senator in a while. You know, it's like, it was like 99% white. So I think creating positions for people of color, I think, is a pretty reasonable thing. And I don't think it's reverse racism, obviously.
I'm actually interested in what you actually think reverse racism is. I don't know if you want to speak.
My understanding of race is it's a systematic, you can't have racism without power. So when someone accuses someone else or an organization of being reverse or practicing reverse racism, it's a way not to take accountability for the larger systemic issues that actually exist. And personalizing an anecdotal situation. That's how I view reverse racism.
Yeah, and I think, again, many people, yeah.
Give round of applause.
Yeah, round of applause. Yeah.
And I think, you know, growing up, I was born in 89, grew up in the 90s, you know, how we learned about racism was, you know, the word structural racism wasn't a word I learned until college, really. So to me, racism was just personal interactions, right? And this very personal form of racism, right? So on the news growing up, there was never any mention of mass incarceration or the war on drugs or these larger issues, but when a white person is the N-word, people got very upset, which they should, of course. But it's very much about kind of focusing on these very specific and personal racist interactions as opposed to focusing on interactions and power as a whole. And so I think that's largely from, again, people who are upset that, you know, individually they can't get a job, whereas on a societal level, as, you know, a white male, again, this isn't saying all white males, right? And again, like, you know, for example, in rural Maine, right, white men are doing not very well. You know, like, rural Maine is very poor, right? Drug use is rampant amongst, you know, men and women. So none of this is to say that being white is easy in America, right? There are many, many poor white people, but compared with the lives of people of color, right, systematically, you know, it's not really the same. So telling poor white people that, and impoverished, and I come from, you know, a very, very, very poor place, telling people that is very difficult for them because they see their lives as oppressed, which in some ways they are too, right? But I think you can simultaneously understand white suffering while still understanding that, still in the grand scheme of things, people of color are treated far worse.
I'm sorry, Stephen, here, we have one more question.
Perfect. And thank you guys again for having this discussion, and thank you for the questions. Yeah.
Yep.
I'm sure Eric. As a white person, how would you respond to someone saying that you don't understand racism or you don't understand oppression because you're white?
That's a really good question. So I asked a very similar, so I made this, like, I was really interested, obviously very interested in the role of white people in, you know, in civil rights movements in general, right? And I, as part of a grad school project, I interviewed like a bunch of white people in my education department who had been doing civil rights movements, been doing civil rights work for a long time. Kind of asked them that kind of question. And, you know, I think ultimately, I don't know what it feels like to walk into a room, as we talked about before, and people stare at me, right? That's not happened to me in my life.
Actually, true.
Well, yeah, but it's different. It's different. It's different. Obviously, you know, I have not, you know, I've never been worried that my name, you know, or my appearance is going to make getting a job more difficult, right? So there are certain things I can't understand, and that, you know, I'm never going to personally relate to in the same way. What I can do is I can listen, you know, as much as I can, and try to understand those things, and then be receptive when people think I'm wrong, right? But also, you know, like, ultimately, like, there are important differences in how white people and people of color are treated in America, of course. But at the same time, you know, like, human empathy, I think, is a pretty strong thing. And even though I can't fundamentally understand exactly what it means, like, to walk into an all-white room and feel uncomfortable, when I hear it enough times, I can get a pretty good idea of it. But I think, you know, one thing this one person told me is that, like, you know, like, people of color have a specific expertise when it comes to explaining racism because of their personal experiences, right? So they have an expertise. That doesn't mean I can't think about it at all or know something about it, right? And again, some things in terms of mass incarceration are just so obvious, and you know, that you know, it's just it's you know, it's there. I can talk about it. So I think it's I think I can do this work, but I think I have to understand that I don't know everything, and then also be willing to be criticized and called out. And when I get called out, it doesn't mean that I'm wrong every time, right? I was talking to you know this same you know older white professors, and they're like, yeah, like you know, I've been called out mad times, and like most of the times the people calling me out were right, you know, and most times people have called me out. Women and people of color, they've been right. But not every time, right? And I have, as a human, I have the capacity to realize if, you know, if someone's saying something to me that is wrong, that I can, you know, try to use my faculties to say, okay, is that actually right or is it actually wrong, right? And if someone, for example, would call me a racist, right? Say that I did something racist, maybe they're right, right? I could have very easily not known I was doing something racist or sexist and still done something sexist or racist, right? And I have to be open to taking that criticism. Doesn't mean that I'm gonna believe everything they say, right? I'm a person, right? I have some faculties, and sometimes people might say things that I don't think are correct, but I have to be able to listen enough and be willing to accept the fact that I could definitely be wrong, and just trying to be open to that.
Yeah, no, and I was gonna say, just to note that Eric, you know, why I appreciate Eric and why I, you know, I appreciate working with him is because he has, you know, actually had the ability to remove himself from his, you know, quote unquote white bubble and, you know, be around, you know, majority people of color where like he is the minority. So like he has come to like the Dominican festival, you know, it's like only white dude in the festival. He's been to like my family's house, you know, he's had dinner with my family. He's hung around with me and my friends who are majority people of color. And I think what's really important to note is that, you know, when you are in these bubbles, I think, you know, it's really important to like, especially if you're about to go to college or something, it's really important to maybe think about going to a college that's, you know, really, really diverse. So you can be in these diverse situations to learn from other people, you know, from different parts of the world. And I think that's, you know, one thing that I really, you know, appreciate about Eric is that, you know, although like, it is scary to go into a situation, you know, where you're, you know, the only person, you know, that looks like you, but to never do that because you're scared is also like, you know, a disservice to yourself in a sense, you know? So how are you gonna learn about other people if you don't put yourself in those situations?
And I was talking with my grad advisor similarly, and I was talking about, it's like, yo, you know, like, obviously like, you know, like I still have internalized racism, of course, right? And again, I was like, yo, it's really hard for me to deal with that sometimes. And like, you know, I'm still ashamed of thoughts I have, and I'm ashamed of things I did in high school and stuff like that. Like, you know, when I was in high school, it was an all white place, or everybody said the N-word constantly as kind of like a joke. It was an all white place, and I did that, right? And I'm ashamed of that. And I was talking to her about this, and I was like, yeah, you know, like, it's you know, like, I doubt myself a lot. And she's like, yeah, you know, it's important to doubt yourself, of course. And like, you know, it's a lifelong process of learning. But also, like, you're doing the work. That's a good thing. I mean, most people, you know, aren't doing this work. And so, I want to forgive myself for the things that I mess up on, too, and just be like, you know, I'm trying my best. But it's a difficult question. But I think I would encourage white people to try to do this work. You know, it's not the hardest thing in the world. You got to just, it takes kind of trying to be honest with your own internalized racism and being honest about how race works in the world. That doesn't mean that I'm not, you know, just because I talk about white privilege and talk about the benefits I've had doesn't mean that, you know, I haven't worked hard, for example, or that I'm not a good person. It means that I'm just being real about the fact that I have things that I don't necessarily deserve, right? And that I've been given things that I didn't earn. And I can still do things with that, right? But just being real with that, I think that's hard for white people to deal with. And it was hard for me to deal with, too. But really great question. And again, you know, it's a difficult thing living in this world in which white people have more privilege that they don't deserve. And figuring out how to deal with that on an individual level is honestly pretty difficult emotionally, just kind of figuring out what your place is. But it's definitely doable. And just, I think it starts from having conversations, you know? But really good question. Thank you for asking that.
So we want to thank you guys for coming out. Appreciate you.
Thank you guys. Appreciate it. Thank you guys.